I was even grasping today for the first time that even, you know, the kind of cumulative effect is that we live, you said something earlier about that notion that even as a society, we have lots of room to grow. We're expressing a type of fear-based, you know,
ego-based, fear-based, and so forth.
Right? Just because that's what we're all in agreement, like attracts like, that's what's occurring, doesn't mean it's
no, that's not,
benefit.
We are not there yet, by all means.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, how many times you heard me talking about our physical existence as a place where people who miss the grade are returning, okay?
Yes.
And they try again and again and again. So we have a lot of room to grow.
So this whole universe is right now watching us and maybe smiling at our...
By all means.
We're like toddlers in creation or teenagers, would you say?
I think we're teenagers. I think we're teenagers. And I mean, all you have to do is just look at the human history. The known history, which is about 10,000 year old. Okay, the known, not even history, the known civilization, this understanding we have. There's no difference then or now. Still now, the only difference, the only improvement we have is, because we have good minds, is into creating better tools, better technology, okay? And we facilitate our life, but that's dangerous too, because it makes harder to learn through suffering, which is the only way to learn.
Which takes me to my very next question.
Very good.
All right, so you know it will be long, so brace yourself. My questions, it always takes me a while to get there. But I would like you to speak to the notion of how our emotions have an impact. You're talking about the interface between the auric body, the invisible auric body, and the physical body. And you talked about that interface being the glands, you know, meaning that the I'm going to get lost in how I describe this. So there's an interface between our emotional body and our physical body, the reflection of our emotional body, which is our true body, our true existence. I can appreciate that. So then there's an extension of that notion of that the types of energetic, emotional things our creation is experiencing has a direct effect on our physical health, on physical expressions of disease. Can you tell me a little bit about how what's happening for us emotionally on the auric body, how that comes into play in our physical experience, our physical existence, my dress.
Okay. What you really asked me first is, what is an auric body?
Okay, well...
I mean, what I have there is a way...
The emotional body.
Is what we are. Yes. That's what we have been creating.
Yes.
Now, and it is the cumulative effect of all our emotional states.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because... as we said, the emotional body is one-to-one correspondence through the major glands.
Yes.
That means that whatever we feel, we do. Okay, so we represent our emotional body. That's how we react. We react on the basis of what we feel. Because our major hormone glands are producing correspondingly the appropriate hormones so that we behave in analogy to what we feel, right?
Yeah.
Okay? So that means, first of all, another question is, what is aura? Because the auric field
is different than the emotional body.
The auric field is actually a encapsulation of all four bodies. But
right.
The aura is whatever we manage through our technology from the auric field to be represented in some kind of consistent way.
Like, and people perceive it as color or?
It is color, because we didn't talk about that.
Oh, okay.
But the fact is that the colors represent energy.
Okay.
Okay. And every color.
A density of energy?
Hmm?
A density or a wavelength?
No, both. Both.
Okay.
Both. Because every color has its own frequency and correspondingly has its own density. Okay? For example, the red color that corresponds to the root chakra.
Yes.
It has a higher density and lower frequency than the third eye, which has lower density and higher frequency, because it is higher.
It's part of that continuum again, the density, the parameter.
It's not continuum, it's an indication. All of this, I can in all of them, I can put here.
That's what I mean. You call it parameter?
They are parameters.
A parameter, okay.
Now, for example, here we have frequency, and there we have density. So each one of them, this is, the root is represented by the red color. The red color has lower frequency and higher density than, let's say, the crown chakra, which has violet color. The violet color, if you look at the frequency of the violet, is much higher than the red. And correspondingly, its density is less. So all of this can be described as energy density zones. Each one of them can be an energy density zone from the energy point of view. Okay? So in other words, the colors are provable as an indications of what the particular chakra, who is associated with the specific gland, represents. To be able to communicate continuously with your higher self and various spiritual teachers and so forth, which means to exercise violet all the time, means you don't have much red. So yeah, you can talk to other worlds, but don't drive, because you're going to kill yourself and others. You understand? You are not grounded enough. The red is essential, is necessary to survive. This is densities and frequencies that relate to daily living. Okay? This is the full body through the pancreas. The sacral, as I told you, represents the satisfaction of the instinct of multiplication. And the root through the adrenals represents the survival instinct and satisfies survival instinct. So if you are to stay on the planet, you need that. If you go very, very small here, you can never go to zero, okay? Because you exist. You have to eat, right? If you don't eat, you're going to lose weight and die. And so forth. I can give you all kinds of examples. But remember, this triad is the physical needs. This triad up there is the communication needs. To communicate with your equivalent, with humans and so forth. To communicate with the spiritual teachers the spiritual component, and finally to be in continuous side-to-side communication with them, to belong there. All right? Now you can't belong there all the time. If you look anybody's aura, it might have some violet. It can be fully violet. Once I saw a gentleman's chakra, and I said, I came and I told him, hey, be careful. Now, if you want to survive, put some red. Put some red. He looked at me, and then I left, And the guy asked the person who was doing the analysis of the chakras, who is that guy who understands that much? And he tells him, oh, you know, he spent a lot of time, he wrote books and so forth. And, the guy was endangered. A young guy. So all I'm saying is you need red. And you have red. On the other hand, there are certain people who have a lot of red and know these colors. These colors are, this is violet, this is indigo. The one associated with the third eye is indigo. Okay? And this number five is represented by blue, light blue. Okay? This is green. Then the solar plexus is yellow. Then we have orange. The sacral is orange, and the root is red. And that's not accidental. But anyway, this is going to be in the book. Actually, the colors about the chakras and so forth, I have already positioned them in the analysis of the chakras in general. They will be referred to in the second book, which is related to the matter. Because don't forget that these things are matter, mm-hmm. but they're the type of matter we cannot see with our eyes. Mm-hmm. We can approach them through cognitive processes, and they are on the astral level. Mm-hmm. But on the astral level, it is emotions that are of importance. Okay? With respect to extrasensory perception and chakras, which are the elements that indicate communication through ESP, you have to go to book number two, which is the forthcoming book.
Can you, now that we've just been describing a little more fully the effects the emotions or feelings have on the physical body, what do you... how would you suggest a person address, they're in pain and they're suffering and they are physically beleaguered? How like in this conversation, how do you feel that they should think about their physical, those physical, the state their body is in? Do they have choice? Do they have ability to shape an outcome?
Yeah, they have. And they have, of course they have. Now, this is a very widespread question you just asked. It really touches the scenario that the humans are susceptible to. If you live in co-create in a scenario where there is absolute poverty, okay, it appears you don't have much to gain. Yet you have, because you don't need much. If you acquire the essentials, you are doing well. Let's take India. In India, they have a lot of problems, but they have also a lot of benefits. Somebody may not be able to educate himself to reach a certain point high in this society, and maybe consider scum of the earth, by other of his compatriots who somehow believe they are better, because they do have this problem. They put themselves into social structures, caste. Yeah. Now, yet, a person of the lower caste, he's not, he can actually, through personal experience and through association with spiritual people, he can understand a great part of the truth that a person who has a better life does not have the time for, and he can move higher towards the right-hand side of the model, simply improving his compromising, his compassion, his acceptance, his moderation, okay? And then he may end up here, although he's starving to death. So there are choices. Depending on the scenario, you can do all kinds of things. And you can be helped by all kinds of other people. Even while you're sleeping, you can be helped. Right? You notice that in certain poor countries, a great part of youth, even in our society, 70 years ago, from every family there was a person who was becoming either a monk or a nun. And these people, you were gaining out of this experience. Maybe they were living in a convent, but nevertheless, there was nothing that they were missing. And then through the association with higher people, they were improving their consciousness. And you notice that even now, let's say in Tibet, every family has a lama, or monks, Buddhist monks, they are all over in these countries over there, men and women, and they gain out of that. All I'm saying is there are many ways. You don't have to really starve. As long as you put yourself in a situation where you're getting the right advice. But everything depends on your consciousness. Whether or not, like a family, if they choose to make a monk out of their boys, the wrong guy, then he won't gain as much as the better guy who has higher consciousness and he could have gained a lot more. But the guy who has higher consciousness will help himself, maybe not as fast as he could if he was part if he was in a monastery. But yet, because he has higher consciousness, he exhibits and he gains out of moderation and acceptance and tolerance a lot more, because he actually lives under worse conditions, and whatever he feels, he really feels it, otherwise he wouldn't do it. Okay?
So a child who's born with extreme handicap, or, you know, that idea that they are a scenario, a type of things that are set, that are there, and that's a learning opportunity, that's a great opportunity.
It is a great opportunity, not only for him, his family and everybody else.
You said for the benefit of everyone, right? Yeah. That idea.
For everybody else. Okay? Mm-hmm.